Welcome to We Are Libertarians. I'm your host, Chris Spangle. We Are Libertarians brings you all of the irreverence modern politics deserves. We explain to you what the hell is happening in our world today and how we can fix it by thinking differently. This is a podcast brought to you by the We Are Libertarians Network. Please be sure to rate and review us on iTunes, like us on Facebook, share this episode with friends, and support us through PayPal or Patreon at wearelibertarians.com. We are supported by listeners like you, so $1 per episode by pledging $5 a month helps us grow. We are always taking your questions and comments via email at editor@wearelibertarians.com. I am Gregless today for you listeners. This is a continuation of our series called The Cost, and we have a new podcast feed talking about the cost of government policy, because when policy is passed and when politicians make laws, they sometimes lose sight of the actual human toll that those government policies take. And if you've heard Amanda's story, Woody's story, you understand. And so today I'm talking to my friend Jess and John about their daughter, Addi, who has epilepsy, correct?
Yes.
And they are here, and we're going to talk about medical marijuana.
We are.
And so Jess and I have known each other through, she used to work where I now work, mm-hmm. and we've become friends over the years. And thank you for joining me, Jess.
Thanks. Thanks for having us. We're excited to talk about it.
Yep. So she was formerly on the Chick McGee podcast, and mm-hmm. she had me on their podcast. And now I'm returning the favor.
Thanks.
So. And John is also with us.
Yeah.
John, this is your first podcast. You're a little nervous. Yes,
my very first podcast. I am a little nervous.
Yes. Well, don't be. I'm very gentle.
Okay.
I promise to be gentle.
Great.
So let's dive into it. I mean, I know of your situation, and you've talked about it on previous podcasts and, mm-hmm. and on Twitter. You're very open about Addi's situation.
Mm-hmm.
But for those who don't know, can you explain who is Addi and what is going on,
sure.
first of all?
So Addi's back. So Addi is, John and I have two children. We have Maxwell, who is 13, a thriving, wonderful teenager boy and all that comes with it. And our other child is Addi, and she is 11 years old. And she was diagnosed when she was
seven years old.
She was diagnosed with bilateral band heterotopia, which is a genetic abnormality that happens at 16 weeks gestation. And when I say this, I always preface it with, this is what they've told me that it happens at 16 weeks gestation. I have no idea.
Sure.
None of us do.
Right.
It could have been malpractice when she was born. I don't know. You know what I mean? It could have been anything. But they say that if they would have given her an MRI or done a brain scan of some sort, they would have told us that this malformation in her brain, which basically your gray matter migrates at 16 weeks gestation throughout your brain.
Oh, okay.
With the white matter, and that's how it works. Well, Addi's.
What's the difference between white and gray matter?
I don't know.
Okay,
that's a real. Right. I don't know, but somehow they must make like some like milky gray color together, and that I don't know, but Addi's didn't migrate.
Okay.
So she has a dense band of gray matter. So it's like if you make a fist, like it's really tight, and there's the, for lack of a better term, that electricity mm-hmm. that travels trying to connect for seizures to make a seizure. There's two ends that need to connect.
Okay.
Well, they're constantly firing, and when they connect, that's when she has a seizure. And that's common with anybody, but hers is just like in a condensed area, like really sure. tight area. So that's how that is. We didn't know until Addi was seven. She'd had this her entire life. We didn't know until she was seven. She had her first physical seizure.
Okay, so she had been having seizures before, but it just didn't manifest itself?
Yes, they say that usually seizures will change form with growth spurts, and that this type of epilepsy, usually between the ages of 7 and 13 is when you'll see the first physical form. We knew something was up in kindergarten when they said, like, your daughter is a really hard worker, and she's not a disciplinarian problem, and she's all these things that she should really be succeeding more than she is.
Mm-hmm.
And standardized mm-hmm. testing, it was not clicking.
The term they kept using was, every day was a clean slate.
Yes.
It was like starting over every day.
Starting over every day.
She comprehended and she worked hard, and she was starting to gather things, but every day it was like a new clean mm-hmm. slate of what did we do the day before?
Yeah, one step forward, two steps back. Heard that a lot from educators. Hmm. And so it wasn't until she was 7 years old over the summer between second and third grade that she had her first physical seizure, a tonic seizure. And I'm just going to, there's 40 different types of seizures.
Okay.
And my daughter, I've done a spreadsheet to figure this out and to map them. She's had about 33 of them.
Mm.
And that's very uncommon for someone to have that many types of seizures. And so often when you think of a seizure, you think of the stereotypical fall to the floor, shake, mm-hmm. and then it's a, or, and shove your wallet in their mouth so they don't bite off their tongue or they don't swallow their tongue. It's impossible to swallow your tongue, people, just so you know.
Okay.
And you never want to stick anything in somebody's mouth while they're having a seizure. You're going to do more harm than that. And so, but there's so many different ones. So Addie's was a tonic. It's mm-hmm. where you become very, very stiff. Your muscles become stiff.
Hmm.
And she just kind of reached out. I think she had juice in her hand and just orange juice flew everywhere. And it was just like a rhythmic kind of like this, but it was long drawn out. It wasn't that like shake, that rhythmic shake that they do. This was like both arms are extended and she was just flailing would be the word.
Was she conscious? Did she?
She was conscious. Like looking at her, you would assume she was conscious. She could not hear us and she wasn't responding.
Okay.
She was breathing. Her eyes were open. It looked like there was activity somewhere, but she was not with us.
She had to look like she was looking through you.
Almost. Yeah, like she didn't see you at all.
She was looking at you, but it was past you.
It was past you. Like there was, yeah, she was just looking. And that's very common too. And that has turned out to be her most common seizure, is that tonic seizure. And but she, like I said, she's had the grand mal, which is what people assume all seizures are.
Mm-hmm.
She's had the absence seizures where it's, that was what we thought was just like a kid where you're like, Addie, 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 you know, and she doesn't respond.
Mm-hmm.
Well, those are those times where she literally clocks out for 30 seconds and she's lost everything, whatever it was. And those were what she had for the longest time. I mean, up from I guess birth until she was seven, that was the most common seizure for her.
So do you take her to the doctor and they immediately know what's going on?
No. They don't. We didn't. We didn't know. We thought
blood sugar.
We thought, you know, like some kind of spasm, like growth or muscle or, you know,
mm-hmm.
I mean, I remember like John's first reaction is like, take her outside, get her fresh air. You know, like we were trying to think of anything.
Get her up and moving.
And then realizing later that, you know, she fell asleep and he and I standing in the closet, just holding each other and sobbing, going, what the hell just happened?
Right.
And I'm going to, so it was probably to get into a pediatric neurologist is, wow, that's a lot. It's a lot of time. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. And you have, we had people who were on the board at the hospital call in for us and say, can you bump this kid up? And some people don't have those connections, but
sure.
Like anything, if you have the connections, you're going to get it.
That is a theme that comes throughout all of the episodes of this series. I mean, it is, if you don't have the right people connecting mm-hmm. you to the right people, you're completely screwed.
You are screwed and you just have to wait. Like we would have had to have wait 3 months probably.
At least
to get into the doctor. And we were so fortunate that they bumped us up and we were probably like 4 weeks probably. Yep. And they did the MRIs and the brain scans and the CAT scans. I mean, they did everything that, from what I remember, 48-hour EKG, all those things, and came back and said, yeah, your daughter has a mass in her brain. And it's not, when
it's
I say mass, it's not a growth. I mean, it is her brain tissue. It's her gray matter. But like I said, the way that it is supposed to migrate, it just didn't do that.
What's the time frame that it takes to finally get that diagnosis?
I'm going to say, so this, her first seizure was in July. And then we went to the doctor in late August.
The 48-hour EKG.
To schedule those things.
October or November.
October. That's what I was going to say. Late October, early November is when they called and said, this is what this is. Mm. Yeah.
So is she having seizures during that period?
No, she didn't really have. I mean, like we would note, we became obviously more aware of like, okay, she's staring and she's not responding. Let's write this down.
Yeah.
Just being aware. There is no one in our family who's ever, I had an aunt who fell and had a couple of seizures after a fall, a head injury.
Mm-hmm.
Same, John has a brother who had like an isolated seizure. Yeah. And so outside of that, no one in our family's ever had epilepsy. We had no idea that that would even be an option.
Mm.
I mean, we were concerned. You think the worst, like what are we going to do? But when we got that diagnosis, we were at Riley and we were like, okay, what medicine do we take? We're ready.
Right.
And we took the medicine. And at that time, no one ever said, and it never entered into our minds, this might not work.
Mm.
Because your child's sick. You live in Indianapolis. You're at one of the best children's hospitals in the world.
Yeah.
You give us medicine and we fix this and we go home.
To give our national audience an idea, James Whitcomb Riley, the author, donated his estate to the local hospital and created mm-hmm. Riley's Children's Hospital. Mm-hmm. And this was 100 years ago in the mm-hmm. 1915. And it has grown into one of the finest facilities in the entire world. People across the world bring their children mm-hmm. to Riley Hospital. So obviously the level of care that your daughter received is not even in question.
No, not at all. Right. Not at all. However, epilepsy is an umbrella term.
Mm-hmm.
To give you an idea, I've connected with one parent in the United States who shares this diagnosis.
Wow. Okay? So it's very rare.
It's very rare.
Right.
And when a child has a seizure and you go to the emergency room, they're okay. Did they fall? Did they have a high fever? Like the basic questions. And as right. many times as we've been to the emergency room, I end up having to school these ER doctors. Sure. Like, this is what this is. And they're what? I've never, they really don't know. I mean, it's like in any job, you're going to know either a general ER doctor. You have a lot to know and a lot to be aware of.
Mm-hmm.
Something so specific and rare. No, they don't always know.
And that can also be a problem because the way that our drug system and our medical system works is it's about volume of sales. So mm-hmm. if they can sell a boner pill to 1,800 million people yeah, around exactly. the world, then they're going to put most of their time and effort into that. If you've got mm-hmm. a diagnosis where you've got two kids in the world with it, they're going to spend less time and money and research on solving that problem.
Right, right.
Have you run into kind of some of that throughout this?
I want to say almost a general disinterest, if that is, I mean, you know, like it's just like, oh, I mean, that's so rare. I mean, there's a stat that talks about the amount of funding and money that goes into, what is it, MS? Do you remember this?
Yes, but I don't remember.
But it's combined. It's three diseases, conditions, however you want to put it. It's three. I'm going to say like MS. I don't know. I wish I had this stat. I'm sorry.
That's okay. Yeah.
But basically saying that more people have epilepsy than these three conditions combined, and yet they're the least funded.
Epilepsy is the least funded. Is that because everybody has seen the MS walks, or mm-hmm. I mean, is it just because there's less awareness, less marketing put around? Like everybody knows the pink, mm-hmm. what that is associated
everybody
with.
Everybody does. And it's also, I mean, no one's taking it and tried to make it a corporation. Nobody's right. taken epilepsy and said, this is what we're going to do. I also, in my opinion, think that there is such a stigma with epilepsy and people who are epileptic and what that entails, and that you can't see it. If you looked at me or if you looked at Addi, obviously, you would have no clue
sure.
that she has this condition.
Right.
This condition that I mean, has the potential to kill her.
Mm-hmm.
You'd never know. So if you can't sell it, if you can't sell this and make money off of it, sorry, I know this is, but they're not going to do it.
Right.
You have to have a poster child, and they don't have that.
Sadly, it's it is ugly, but you know, you think about muscular dystrophy and Jerry Lewis and the telethons all those years, you know, the big money getter is the kid in the wheelchair coming out. Yeah,
it's 100% true.
Makes sense.
It's 100% true. I can't. I share our story on all social media because I have yet, like I said, I found one other mother. And if there's another family out there that goes to hashtag seizures suck or whatever it is that I put on there that time and says, oh my God, here's a family. Oh my God, they're going through the exact same thing we're going through. That's the reason that I share our story. Yeah. So that someone else goes, oh, they tried this medicine and it didn't work the first time, but then they did this or whatever it is. That's why I share our story. Can I take a video of my daughter having a seizure and put it up on social media? I could. Would it get the response that I want? Probably not.
Sure.
It would offend people because it's ugly. Mm-hmm. It's ugly. It's scary. It doesn't give you the warm and fuzzies. There isn't a happy ending here. Right now, there is not a happy ending. Because my daughter has refractory epilepsy. We've gone through some of these medicines we've tried twice, but we're up to 13 different medications.
Yes. And every time you tap on the table, that
I'm so sorry. That's okay. I'm such a hand talker.
I know.
I'm so
I know.
Sorry. I'll do it on my legs. Sorry.
Move. Yeah. I hate to interrupt that emotional, passionate point with that, but edit that part out. So you get the diagnosis, and I can't imagine. I mean, what is the reality? What is the reaction to that as parents? I mean, that's got to be. I'm not a parent. The closest thing I have is cats, you know, and it's not even remotely.
You have nieces,
I have nieces, yes.
Yeah.
And I couldn't imagine my nieces having, you know, because you have, the way that I look at my nieces, I'm just like, wow, look at all the potential. Look at the great life they have ahead of them.
Yeah.
I mean, what are some of the reactions that you guys go through once you have this diagnosis?
Yes. I'll try to touch on it a little bit just with what, initially, I always said as a dad, and my trade, the job I go to every day is an electrician, and as a role as a dad, you want to fix it. Mm-hmm. You know, how can I fix this?
Right.
And I go back to, you know, like I said, what I do for a living. You know, give me some tools. Give me, you know, where's the fix? There's got to be. You know, if the medicine's not working, then there's a surgery, there's a device, there's a diet, you know. We've been down all those paths, but our initial response as parents was, you know, let's find the fix. So now we know, let's find the cure. If there's not a cure, let's find a way that she lives comfortably and can continue to
treat the symptoms.
Right, and continue to grow and continue to be a great kid. As more and more things came in, less medicines were working, then you start to go down that path of, you know, she may not drive. She's not going to go into a normal classroom. You know, she's not going to, you know, there's all these things that start to come on that, you know, like you touched on with your nieces, it hits you right square in the stomach that, and especially to contrast to a brother that's 2 years older that, as you know, it does have all the potential in the world. Mm-hmm. And how do you, as a parent, how do you apply this to say, hey man, you know, you have all this, Max, and she may not have all those things. So it's a tough balance to, and I could go down a path where tears are flowing, but try to, it's tough to handle not knowing what her future is the biggest part of that diagnosis for us as parents, I think.
Yeah. Also, so the medication, we've done the 13 medications that have failed. After your first medication fails, your chances of the second medication working drop to 30%. Mm. And then the third medication working drop to 12%. And so after that, they're pretty sure nothing's going to work.
Right.
Our daughter is not a candidate for surgery because her epilepsy, her seizures develop on both sides of the brain. Mm. They will operate on one side of the brain because now they know that when you do operate for many different things on one side of the brain, the other side will make up the difference.
Right.
Okay. But right now, today, they're not operating on both sides of the brain for epilepsy. Will they someday? Maybe. Do we want our daughter to be one of the first surgeries? Probably not. So that's the option. Another option for treatment is a VNS. That's a vagal nerve stimulator, or vagus. I've heard it both ways. And it wraps around the vagus nerve in the back of the, in the, at the base of the skull. And they have different ones.
It's the big nerve that connects your nervous system to your brain. Yes. And so, like, if you work out and you throw up, it's because you built up so much lactic acid. It hits that nerve. It thinks you're being poisoned.
Mm-hmm.
It's why when I get my blood drawn, I faint because I think I'm being attacked. And so what it does is it just says, hey, system, shut down.
Right. Yeah. Right. So this, so the old school VNSs used to have a magnet that you could put the magnet into the chest, and the patient could take the magnet when they felt an aura. That's what you feel before you have a seizure.
Okay.
And they could put it on that magnet and it would divert the seizure. It wouldn't let those two connectors come together and cause the seizure. It would shut it down. Mm. Yes.
It would trigger that.
From what we've read with Addie's condition, and the, and we know of a girl who had it that has Addie's condition, it worked just the same as medication. It worked for a few months and then it stops. Mm. And that's how it's always been. Addie has this 3-month honeymoon period where everything seems great and this is the medicine and we're, it's going to be awesome. And then it stops. So once you have a VNS put in, you can't have it taken out. It's there forever.
You can have it shut off.
You can have it shut off, but it's going to be there forever. Mm-hmm. And so, until we get to a point where that's like a last option, but we're, as medicine, as medication has shown, this probably isn't going to work either.
Mm-hmm.
So why go through this? And, you know, the chances of something going wrong with that. I don't know.
I mean, at a certain point, do you just say, all right, enough going to doctors, we're just going to deal with this? Or, I mean,
that's where we are right now.
Okay.
We've done, sorry, go ahead.
No, I think we've been there before. We've seen a holistic.
We've gone to an osteopath. We've done acupuncture. Yeah. We've done essential oils. People, we know it's an option. It is not an option for us. It doesn't work for us. It works for some, not for us. The craze of essential oils. People think that that's gonna fix everything.
They're very intense.
They are.
They're like the it works people.
Yes, exactly. Which, you know what? I get it.
Very passionate.
Yes, and we like for our house to smell good too, but it's not gonna treat our daughter's epilepsy.
Right.
We have tried everything, and right now we're to the point where we go to the places that help Addie recover the quickest. Okay. So our osteopath is one of those things. Acupuncture is one of those things. Massage, just things that make her comfortable and help keep her relaxed.
Right. So you can't prevent it on the front end at this point, so you're just going to try and make it better on the back end.
Right.
I've had an aura once. I was actually at work. This was probably about a year ago, and my eyesight, I just had this super bright thing in the front of my vision, and I couldn't stand. I started getting dizzy. It was one of the most terrifying experiences of my entire life, because I'm 33. I still consider myself invincible. And so I called my mom and asked her what was going on, and she told me to, you know, you're having an aura. But it was really, really frightening. I mean, how does Addi deal with this? Because, you know, either does she know what's coming on when she has that? I mean, and then, I mean, what's her attitude like?
We always said that Addi has had this brain since she was born.
Mm-hmm.
So when she turned 7 and we realized she had this brain, she was like, well, thanks for finally catching up on what the hell's going on with me, you know? Like, she has just had to counteract and just adjust her entire life. So she doesn't know any different.
So she doesn't have that same kind of fear where it's like, oh.
It's more an annoyance is what I would say, because we were in the car yesterday and she had 11 seizures in the span of an hour. And that went from tonic to the auras, which we consider, like, we clock that, the auras, to absence, to all kinds. But she looked at me and she was like, why is this happening?
Right.
And hers are, you see her eyes will pull in a direction. Mm. And they pull so hard that it's like, it's uncomfortable. You know, like when you look out of the corner of your eye too long?
Right.
Hers do that on their own and they pull and it's uncomfortable. It doesn't feel good. And she just gets so frustrated because she says, I can't look where I want to look. Mm. But to go ahead and jump into the topic of CBD oil. Mm-hmm. I don't know if very many people know that it is legal to ship CBD oil on a federal level.
Explain what it is, please.
Okay. CBD oil is, cannabis has millions of strains. The biggest two being CBD and THC. Mm-hmm. THC is the component you get the psychoactive, the high.
Most of our audience, being a libertarian podcast, would be familiar with the concept of THC.
Okay. Yes. They're familiar with that. Well, CBD has so many healing benefits, as does THC, but CBD is the one that doesn't get you high as well.
Okay.
So the Stanley brothers really brought this to light in the documentary Weed, I believe it is, and where they made a strain of CBD that had no THC in it, but it was a cannabis plant and cannabis hemp. I try not to say marijuana anymore because marijuana actually it has nothing to do with cannabis.
Sure,
or hemp.
That's a slang term.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. It's actually like a really crazy tobacco. That's not even, it doesn't apply.
Right.
But they developed, the Stanley brothers developed this strain of CBD and used it on a little girl named Charlotte Figgy, who mm-hmm. was having like hundreds of seizures a day, had not walked, had not talked, nothing. And I think her dad maybe stumbled upon this, saw it on a YouTube video and called his wife, and he was a soldier. He was overseas. Like I really recommend the documentary Weed as a starter place of how this all became so popular and mainstream now. Mm-hmm. But they gave it to her and like within minutes, her seizure stopped.
Wow.
Yes. And so you have these families who are hearing these stories who have these children with refractory epilepsy and they're moving to Colorado. Hmm. We're going to get this Charlotte's Web strain of CBD oil. So CBD is being used for lots of things now. However, this Charlotte's Web, the strain that we use, that we have shipped from the Stanley brothers here to Indianapolis, is what we use on Addi. And you have to be very mindful of when you use it. We learned the hard way up front that our daughter gets oversaturated quickly.
Okay.
It's a cannabinoid. And I know people all say that different. Mm-hmm. Saturation. And so we had to start like literally with a drop and work our way up. And we're only about 3/4 of the way of where she could be. And
well, if I can jump in on dosage, we started with a drop. We're now at maybe 12 to 20 drops per dosage and two of those a day. But the issue and the issue with policy and law is that nobody's allowed to study it enough to tell you what the right dosage is.
Sure. Yeah.
So we're saying we're 3/4 of the way to a dosage, but medically speaking, no one really knows.
No one really knows. Yeah. And when you sign up to put your child on this oil, you become the doctor and the pharmacist and, you know, the caretaker and all these things. And it's trial and error.
Yeah.
And yeah.
Let me, for our skeptics out there, let me kind of just give, and you guys feel free to jump in.
Sure.
Because I'm sure you know as much about this as I do, if not more. The reason that marijuana was legal, I mean, up until the 20s and 30s across the nation. And Indiana actually has a stamp tax on it. That you can go in, and if you bring a pound of pot, they'll put a $3.20 stamp on it. Hemp as well. And in the 20s and 30s, you had William Randolph Hearst and many other newspaper folks and the paper industry and the logging industry. They started to see the competition from hemp. Hemp can have, in Indiana, for example, three crops a year. and it grows really well in Indiana. That's why we have ditchweed. You'll see ditchweed around the state occasionally as people throw it out the window, their joint. And, you know, the Constitution was written on hemp paper. George Washington had hemp farms. It is a very hardy and useful material. The fibers in World War I and I believe World War II as well, were those uniforms for our soldiers were made out of hemp. Mm-hmm. And it because it was such a hardy crop, it became competition because it was so abundant, because you can get so, you know, think of the lifespan of a tree to make paper versus hemp three times a year. And so William Randolph Hearst started equating hemp and marijuana, again, a slang term, and cannabis with serial killers, black men raping white women, and that's how the movement to prohibition began. It was an economic thing by people who had vested interest in control of the public opinion, who eventually outlawed marijuana, cannabis and hemp all mm-hmm. across the nation, and it is a Schedule I drug. And
that's laughable.
Right, on the federal register. And Schedule I means that there is zero medical benefit for marijuana. It is, you know, it is the same as crack. It is, in the eyes of the federal policies, it is the same as crack, heroin, meth. I don't think there has been one recorded death of marijuana.
Not that I'm aware of.
In terms of overdosing. Obviously, there's deaths associated with traffic accidents and other things, but marijuana has not only shown, you know, pot has not only shown that it is medically beneficial. It, if you look in recreationally, crime has gone down in Colorado, Oregon. Mm-hmm. You know, it'll go down in Maine as they legalize it. It's and the revenue, it's like expanded the Colorado revenue. Although we libertarians are not for, you know, make it legal and tax it. We'd like to just make it legal, period. But yeah. If you look at what is going to get legislators to take this next step, they talk money. They don't talk human terms. They talk what's going to get them enough revenue so they can build football stadiums. So
yes,
because that makes them look like heroes.
Right.
So we have a plant, a natural plant that is beneficial, and medicine is plants, okay? I was talking with somebody who runs an herbal business, and mm-hmm. not like herbal and, you know,
no.
like selling mushrooms and illegal drugs, but somebody who heals with herbs.
Herbalist,
yes. Yeah. And, you know, Eli Lilly is here in Indianapolis and has hundreds of jobs tied to this area. Well, mm-hmm. they used herbs and plants to get drugs mm-hmm. to heal us. Mm-hmm. And so it isn't out of the realm of possibility that CBD oil or cannabis can heal people. Mm-hmm. And it also creates a lot of jobs. There are a lot of people who listeners may be familiar with Daniel and Chris Peffers and Maya. All three of them have gone out to Colorado. Here, they were losers. There, they have great jobs and great lives, and they're succeeding. So it's great. But that is why pot is illegal. That is why it is so persecuted. You have, and because it is a Schedule I drug, because it is illegal, colleges cannot study it. It is they are regulated out from studying any of the effects of marijuana. And I will say, Hillary Clinton, this is one of the places where I agreed with her in this last election. Hillary Clinton said that if she were elected president, she would deschedule it and allow universities to start studying the effects so we mm-hmm. would know what was in it. And when you don't have a black market in places like Colorado, but here in Indianapolis, you do. Mm-hmm. You do have a black market, and that makes the actual product that you consume less safe, as right. opposed to a university releasing studies and saying, here's what's beneficial. So that is just your little lesson on marijuana and why it is illegal. And mm-hmm. so you have found that CBD, what does it do for Addi? What is the time frame you've been using it, and what are the noticeable differences that you've been?
We started using it in late September, early October. And that's another thing. Like we said, like there's There's no, it's like anything. It's like when you flip something over and says, has not been approved by the FDA, da 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 da. When you take any supplement, really.
But yeah.
Yeah. So that's the thing. We really had to do our homework and see what pesticides these different CBD oil farms were using in Colorado and in California and going, okay, pesticides. She's very sensitive to some things and we don't know everything that she's sensitive to yet.
Sure.
So we had to do that. That's another reason why legalizing this would be really helpful, because then we would know. So Addi started using it late September, early October. And like John said, we dose differently in the morning and in the evening, trying to work up to the full dose. Have we seen a decrease in seizures? No. Have we seen a schedule? This is what I say. This medication has done this for us, where Addi will have between 20 and 23 days, is how it's been since we started this, of no seizures. And that's the first time that's happened. That's the longest that she's gone.
What was typical before?
A day, 2 days, 3 days, and maybe.
So she's getting 20 days apiece.
She's getting 20 days. And not only that, she's getting 20 days and functioning on alongside of her peers. Mm-hmm. So along with Addie's condition, she has severe cognitive delay. Socially, she's very, very awkward. Very sweet, but very awkward. She's a fifth grader. She's 11. There's girls that have boyfriends and right. There's things that are happening that Addi has zero interest in, which, hey, we'll take that part of it for sure. but socially, she's kind of a loner. I mean, she has fun. She enjoys playing by herself. She still plays dolls and she likes singing in front of the mirror and all those things. But when it comes to a social situation, we have witnessed her being around other little girls her age and Addi just kind of like just observing. Mm-hmm. But if you go to what children mentally at first or second grade are doing, they're observing each other, they're trying to learn from each other. So technically she's where she is mentally and she's doing the right thing. Mm-hmm. But that gap is going to continue to widen greatly, right? There's going to be a time where she's 16 or 17 and she's just going to stop maturing. Mm-hmm. But what we've seen since we started taking the oil is that delay is less. And I don't know how libertarians feel about standardized testing, but we spend a lot of time in the education system testing our children. Mm-hmm. This is the time where I have been a fan of it, because they test in August and they test again in December. And Addi, for the first time in her life, has come up in the standardized testing, which is huge. So with that, she's remembering more. It's increasing her memory. It's increasing her ability to comprehend the information.
Well, her brain, it doesn't sound like her brain's being interrupted.
It's not being interrupted as often.
Yeah.
Yes.
As we talked about the clean slate before of, you know, every day being a brand new day in some sense, and especially in a, mm-hmm. a school setting, I think the medicine has allowed her to continue on to the next day and remember what I did the day before and not have those resets, in between that I think that medicine has allowed her to do that. Mm-hmm. It hasn't been the success story that you might see on.
Yeah, we're not Charlotte Figgy. Our seizures didn't stop the day she started taking it.
And we haven't given up on it by any means, mm-mm. But it's changed. It's changed her. It's changed us. It's allowed a lot of things that other medicines weren't.
So she'll have seizures. They call them clusters. They'll mm-hmm. start in a cluster, and the cluster will last 24 to 48 hours. Recently, we've had a longer cluster. It's the longest cluster we've had since we've started the medication. However, our daughter very well may be one of those patients that would benefit from a very, very tiny dose of THC to a very, very large dose of CBD.
What's the difference?
THC is the psychoactive component, but that mild, I mean, tiny, tiny bit is what could relax the brain, is what could allow the CBD oil to work further.
Okay, so same theory as, you know, if you take vitamin D, you want to have some you got to take vitamin D to have calcium supplements work, for instance, because the two synthesize. If you take vitamin E, you've got to eat some fat with it because it synthesizes correctly.
Exactly.
CBD doesn't have that psychoactive component, mm-hmm. and so therefore it's not getting into the blood breaking through the blood brain barrier. Mm-hmm. Is that what the
That's what I would
is?
Say. I would say because, so, like you said, sometimes you need that aid when you have two things that could be helpful to your body. So, so obviously the THC giving her enough to let the brain go, oh, okay, instead of fighting this I'm just going to relax and let this do its work. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So it would be that. We're not giving her THC, you know, to watch Cheech and Chong movies with her. We're giving her THC so that her CBD oil can work more efficiently.
Right.
We're not giving her THC at all. But if we did, that's the benefit. And that's how they do it with some. I don't think that they give THC to children except in the very, very rare cases. And obviously in the states that it's legal, you can't ship THC obviously to Indiana and it be okay. Mm-hmm. But I was at Fresh Thyme yesterday, a grocery store chain, fairly natural, holistic grocery store chain.
It's where I shop exclusively.
Okay,
I love
there
it.
You yep. go.
It's,
okay.
it's like a it's like Whole Foods and Meijer had a baby.
Yes.
Whole Foods and Target had a baby. Yeah.
I like it. That's very true. But they are now carrying a brand of CBD and they keep it locked up in there. And I mean, people can, I take this, I use that brand. Mm-hmm. I don't use the Charlotte's Web for myself, but I use it just for, I mean, I have severe dementia that runs in my family and I'm trying to do things like to be proactive. I don't want that to affect me later in life.
Same. That's why I go to Fresh Thyme and get organic food.
There you go. Exactly. Yeah. Where you're trying to do the things you're trying to beat, you know, heredity, I guess.
Yeah. So you've noticed, and so has it been it's been past that 3-month window now where
we are past that 3-month window, right, and that's what's concerning now is that we're past that 3-month window and this last little burst has lasted longer than any of them have.
That's good.
So that's where we're concerned where, okay, is this going to come? Like, how much time do we have now between the next cluster that visits? But that's where John and I are not, we're not doctors. We're not pharmacists. We shouldn't have to figure this out on our own.
Well, and you'd know the effects and you'd be more likely like to use THC if it had been studied.
Absolutely, but I also don't know the effects of THC on a young 11-year-old brain.
Exactly,
no
right.
No one does.
No one does. No one should.
Right. We know caffeine and coffee stunts their growth.
Right.
but that's because it's been studied, and it's the same principle here. If it were descheduled, if it were academics were allowed to research it in test situations, then you as a parent would be more informed and more empowered, and by prohibiting the access, you make people, this is one of the costs of this bad policy, is that parents get less choice and the child suffers more because of the lack of choice that can be made.
Yes. And so with Senate Bill 15, if we can talk about that.
Here in Indiana,
that is a bill that's specific to refractory epileptic children. That is, which obviously, okay, medicine doesn't work. Medicine has failed. It's called intractable. It's called drug resistant, refractory. There's a lot of different words for it. And it's for children. So to pass this would allow doctors to prescribe CBD oil for these very specific cases.
That's great. Our Indiana legislative writer, Phyllis Klosinski, is actually working on an article around this, and she just wrote on Senate Bill 255, which is introducing medical marijuana here in Indiana too. So even a conservative state like Indiana is starting to take a look at this stuff. So if you're in Indiana and you're listening, please call your state legislator and ask them to advocate for those two.
Yes.
And I know that, Jess, if you want to give out your Twitter, you've tweeted about this if people want to find the legislation.
Yes, I am at the Jess Expo, and I share our story openly. I am more than happy to discuss it with anybody who's looking into it in a similar situation. I mean, CBD oil is being used to treat a number of things now, not just epilepsy. And so I went to dinner with a friend the other day who has a child with ADHD, and she was like, do you think this could help? And I honestly think that people should take CBD as you take a multivitamin. Mm-hmm. Obviously there's different potencies that are necessary. Like the medical grade that Addi takes isn't necessary. It's definitely not the one I take. And, but it's so beneficial.
What are the benefits of it? Is it anti-inflammatory?
Anti-inflammatory. We can look it up if you want, and please. I can read off all of the fun things.
I'll pad. We won't ask John to pad while we do that. But inflammation in the body is really, it's what causes dementia. It's what causes, I recently lost 10 pounds by getting off of grain just because it stops inflaming my body. So it's how the Biggest Loser people lose all that weight is they just stop eating crap food that inflames their body. And so if it would make sense that if it's anti-inflammatory, that it would kind of help calm things down.
Sure.
Think about your inflammation inside your tissues and your organs. Think about how tender something is when you get a bug bite on your arm and it gets red and inflamed, or a pimple. That's skin inflammation. So yeah, this seems to be a no-brainer to me. It just doesn't make any sense that something that is natural in a plant, especially when we've seen it tested in other places like Colorado, where it's legal, it's really starting to help people and create whole industries.
Right. I think to speak to the bill, I think it says a lot. And I know this is that it's a Republican sponsored bill. It's authored by Republicans. It's not some far left hippie or a libertarian that's bringing this to the table that has in the past. I think you're starting to see a real, like you said, you got to talk money if you're going to talk about these things. But I think it speaks to the real medical benefits, that it's not a party issue necessarily, and especially here in Indiana.
Sure.
And that's why we tell our story, is that hopefully anybody can listen and anybody will hear and let's talk more about it, because it's not a party issue. It's not something that should divide anybody. It's a medical solution.
We appreciate you guys telling your story, because it normalizes this stuff. It makes people go, oh, this isn't a bunch of pot smoking hippies, which why is that even a bad thing? I mean, honestly, it's old stereotypes from this era. Our great great grandparents, when they outlawed it, and now we're rolling that back, and it's great.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Unfortunately, when we've contacted our state rep, the term gateway drug is still used.
Feel free to say his name.
It's Mike Kreider. Mm-hmm. And he said, I'm under the impression that it's a gateway drug, was his email response back to me. And it was, I giggled. I was like, you can't be serious.
Because it's laughably stupid.
Yes. It just blows my mind. But I can't tell you how many people that we know very closely are like, you're giving your kid weed? And I was like, are you being serious? Like, people are just very uneducated about it. And that's the unfortunate part. But I mean, like we said, the CBD oil, the benefits are just, it's insane. It's an antibacterial. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Inhibits cancer cell growth. Okay. Promotes bone growth. Reduces seizures and convulsions. Reduces blood sugar levels. Helps the immune system and anti-inflammatory. Reduces the risk of artery blockage. Helps with small intestine contractions. We have a friend that we know that suffers from that. It aids in vomiting and nausea, relieves pain, relieves anxiety, slows bacterial growth, suppresses muscle spasms, treats psoriasis.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's again, so it just doesn't make any sense that it should. So
no.
Feel free, if you're listening, please, let's tweet at Mike Kreider and explain to him. Please send him the facts. Be respectful, but send him the facts that marijuana is not a gateway drug. If anything is a gateway drug, it's back surgery and then going on OxyContin. Yeah. That is a gateway drug. We're not seeing kids fall into the dangers of pill use by smoking pot. They're doing it by getting pills from their mom's closet because she had back surgery. That's the other thing
that the medications that we gave our daughter before we realized that she was refractory were benzodiazepines. These, I mean, completely altered our daughter's personality, made her depressed, made her lethargic. I mean, there were days where she would not get out of bed. She was a 9 years old.
Mm-hmm.
That I don't know. I mean, it's sad to see someone suffer from depression, but when it's a 9 year old girl and you know that it's completely altered because of prescription medication, it's altered her being completely. That's devastating. And not only that, but the long term use of benzos, she would have had to have a kidney or a liver transplant by the time she was 30.
Holy cow.
Yes, people don't realize. I promise you. Yeah,
you can't
that's
be
the
on
thing.
It for 20 years.
Yeah, and, you can't be on it for that long.
And not have the side effects of...
Yeah, it's going to deteriorate your entire body. And that's what's so sad is that when the symptoms outweigh the side effects, or the side effects outweigh the symptoms, what do you do? And that's exactly what was happening.
Right. Well, I have a huge issue. There's a documentary that outlines a lot of this really well called Prescription Thugs that is on Netflix right now. And, you know, I have a huge problem with our pharmaceutical industry, the way that we're only one of two nations in the world that allow us to be marketed to by drug companies. Mm-hmm. And so what happens is you find things as you watch TV that you think, oh, I should get some medicine for that ache, that pain. It's almost creating. It's, you know, polio was cured by medicine. Mm-hmm. We used to cure diseases with medicine. Now we maintain symptoms through medicines. And that's a very different psychology. Mm-hmm. And so our pharmaceutical industries, you know, just like every other area that we ever discuss on this podcast, the profit motive becomes the thing that ends up corrupting the industry, and that ends up hurting people.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got to really be an educated consumer. Like, and I commend you guys for being educated consumers of doctors and opening up to every different aspect. I think that's really, I would be the same way if I had a kid that was,
sure,
you know, going through this kind of stuff.
Yeah, you have to. I mean, John and I are pretty laid back people, and the last thing we'd ever assumed to be were advocates of anything. Like, we're not even fans of anything. Like, everybody loves John Mayer and we're like, nah, whatever. But it's just, we're just not like that. And so, but when you're put in this situation, and not only is your own child suffering, but there are thousands of children suffering.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't think that that's what people don't understand, is that 30% of epilepsy patients are refractory.
Mm.
That means medicine doesn't work for 30% of the people diagnosed. That's insane. So now what? Now what do these people do? Their chances for SUDEP, which is sudden unexpected, is this right? Sudden unexpected death due to epilepsy, something like that. That when you are refractory, your chances of no. When you have epilepsy, your chances of dying from SUDEP go from, it's 1 in 1,500, okay? When you're ruled refractory, it goes to 1 in 150. There's 1 in 150. People will die because they don't have a form of treatment for their epilepsy. I mean, that's kids, that's adults, that's everybody. That seems really high.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. That always gets me. That always bothers me because, like I said, and we've shared our story on social media, I've had people private message me and said, thank you so much. This is the latest one that hit me. And it's hard to read. It was a teenage girl. And she said, my family moved. My mom and my sister left my siblings and I and my dad and moved to Colorado in hopes of finding a medicinal marijuana or a cannabis that would work. And in the process of looking, this little girl died from SUDEP.
Mm.
In the middle of the night, her mom went in there and she had suffered a seizure and she was dead when she found her the next morning. And they had relocated because they didn't have any other options, left their family behind to try to save their daughter's life. And just didn't have a chance. There wasn't time.
And you think about it, it's a gateway drug. Well, that's not the compassionate, empathetic response.
No.
The Colorado situation is a much more compassionate, empathetic response.
Yeah.
It is much more caring of individuals. And it's sad that she passed, but at least she had that option. You know?
She did.
And so I think take a look at SB 15. Is it right?
Yes.
SB 15, and
it has passed out of committee. So it should get a vote.
That's huge. Yep. Okay, if you don't know how legislatures work, it is a lot like the federal government. You have something that is introduced, it's written, you have the author and co-signers. It goes to a committee. Usually, most things don't make it out of a study committee, let alone making it to a committee, and then passing to the entire floor and getting a hearing. So it's important that it gets a hearing, gets an up and down vote. So you've got to really contact your legislator if you're here in Indiana. And if you're not in Indiana, if you're in other states, take the SB 15 bill, take the language, and talk to your state legislator and see if you can get this introduced in your state. Because that's what Alec does. Be a libertarian Alec. Alec is the Association of Legislative something. Look up ALEC. And it takes legislation and it standardizes it across legislatures across the nation. Well, you can do the same thing. Yeah. Just find out state legislative efforts that you agree with. Take that language. Say to your state senator and your state rep that you want to replicate that.
Yeah. It's we're grateful because we've people that we are around now, like John works on a job site with 600 guys, and he has more people coming up to him and saying, hey, your daughter has epilepsy. Yeah, I heard about, like, even that it's in someone's vocabulary right now, even that they're aware of it. That's a huge step because, like I said before, there was such a stigma that surrounded it.
Right.
Like, you know what? If you could just, like, keep them out of eye shot, we don't want to see any of that. That's ugly. That's not, you know. And now that people are aware and saying, oh my gosh, here's this little girl who loves to go to the theater and loves to go to her brother's wrestling meets and would sing Taylor Swift until her mom loses her mind. I mean, like, that's the face of epilepsy is not one person. It's so many different stories and for so many different reasons. And I feel like everybody deserves a treatment option.
All right. So final thoughts, John. He almost got the hang of it.
No, I am.
You're doing good, babe.
Yeah, sorry. I will say that I'm not a public person in the sense that I don't like to share my story. I like to hear your story. I like to learn about other people, and I like to know where they come from, what they do, how they get there, those types of things. That's been my background. It's been very eye-opening and challenging for me to share this story in a sense that, you know, sometimes we don't get that choice that this is our family. And but with the oncoming of social media and different things that allow us to share the story a lot faster, a lot more broad, it's to feel the love and concern of the community and friends that comes back once we share the story, and to see them catching on to that story and sharing it with their friends and getting some connections of other people or anything that goes with it. I think that's what we're after. Whether this bill passes or not, whether, you know, I think someday down the road it will, I hope it's in time that we all get to benefit from it. But, I just encourage everyone to share your own story, because somebody out there is looking to connect to you for whatever reason, whether it's epilepsy or libertarians or whatever that your cause is. I just encourage everybody to keep sharing that story, and just does the best. So,
oh, thanks. Yeah, I just to touch on what John said, when John's, you know, lifelong Republican grandpa shares our, hey, pass medical cannabis on Facebook, like, we've done something, you know, that's huge.
Right.
And then it'll slowly spread, and it has. And even in our small community of New Pal on the east side of Indianapolis, that people are aware of it, that people are talking about it, and they know that Addi Hooker takes CBD oil, and that it's treating it. It's not treating it as quickly as we would like. It's not treating it exactly how we planned, but that's Addie's story. Nothing has gone as planned.
Sure.
And so we're going to continue to work our asses off to make sure that she has the best quality of life possible, that she gets to have those first, that she gets to drive a car, even if it's in our backyard and she's not licensed. We're going to let her drive a car. We're going to let her have those experiences of maybe going to a college class once a week. It might not be the ideal situation, but just letting each child, each person have those firsts and have those experiences that we all deserve is what's important.
And liberty is about not having someone stop any of that progress.
Exactly.
Or limit it.
Yes.
Well, thank you for joining us. I would be remiss if I didn't mention that Jess is part of the blonde on brunette duo.
The lighter side of my life.
Yeah, Caitlin would kill me if I didn't plug that. So, blonde on brunette. It is a great... I actually watched my first episode the other day. I laughed. I loved it. It was adorable. So check it out on YouTube. if you want to get in touch with Jess, it is at the Jess Expo. Please say it for me.
I am at the Jess Expo. And you can also follow me on Instagram. It is Jess Hooker _. And that's actually where I share the pictures and our very specific story, the longer posts about Addi and what we're going through and what's worked and what's not. And that's been going on for a couple of years now. You can scroll back pretty far and see what's going on with us. We share the bad days. We share the good days. And hoping... It helps someone.
Check it out. And if you hit up any legislators, please let Jess know. We help network and get involved. So thank you to Jess and John Hooker for joining us. And thank you for sharing your story. And please, if you're listening, get involved. Call your state senator. Call your state representative. Call the governor's office. And if you're not in Indiana, do this in your state. This has been an episode of We Are Libertarians. We thank you for joining us on this episode. Thank you for joining us on this episode of We Are Libertarians. We appreciate you listening very much.